And good evening. Thank you so much for watching Healthline here on PBS 39 HD. I'm your host, Mark Evans. A very interesting topic tonight, as usual, here on Healthline. We're talking very candidly about colorectal disease, and in specific, to start with, is understanding colitis. We have a very special guest back on Healthline for, what, the third time now, Dr. Hisham Elhassan, who is a colon and rectal surgeon. It's great to have you back.
Thank you. Thank you for having me again, Mark.
And we'd like to encourage everyone who's watching to give a phone call and not to be shy.
We're happy to respond to all those questions.
All right. And the telephone number is on your screen at 969-2720. That is a local number. And, of course, we have a long-distance toll-free number as well, 866-969-2720. Please call anytime in the next 25 to 30 minutes. We will not stop down for commercials. The show is for you and understanding any of the subjects we discuss here on Healthline, for instance, colitis tonight. And Dr. Elhassan, what is colitis exactly?
Okay, that's a very good way to start, actually.
All right.
The term colitis, people using it a lot of time in different ways. And sometimes they refer to it as stomach pain or diarrhea. But for the medical personnel or people in the medical field, physicians, nurses, it means a specific thing. And by that I mean, if we talk about the colon, it's about 5 feet long tube that where we do most of our absorption of fluid, water, and some of our electrolytes. The inner layer from inside, which is a mucosa lining, that's the part that gets affected when we have colitis. It gets some inflammation, and that can present by swelling or redness. And the main thing, it affects the function of that layer, which is very important for the functions of the colon.
Mm-hmm.
And by that, that's what we say colitis. Now, it could be an acute and self-limiting disease that can happen within a week. You have symptoms and it resolves and you keep going on with life without a problem. And it could be also a very chronic problem with persistent, recurrent attacks that can affect long term.
So this actually can go away by itself without any medication or treatment?
Yes, in some forms.
In some forms. Now there are more than just one form.
Definitely. There are different types of colitis. And the way we talk about colitis is we talk about infectious colitis, which is the kind of colitis that's related to virus, bacteria, and by that I mean like Salmonella, Shigella, or the very famous one now, C. diff colitis, which is affecting a lot of patients in hospitals, in nursing homes, and stuff like that. This is one group. There is another group, which is people always hear about Crohn's or ulcerative colitis. These are other forms of colitis. And then there is other different types of colitis that we can talk about.
All right. What are the symptoms? Are they pretty much generalized for all the types of colitis?
That's a very good question, actually. The symptoms are very generalized, that actually part of the symptoms that affects the GI disease system in general.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very important for people actually to seek some medical care about it, because if you think about the symptoms of colitis, the first common one is diarrhea, abdominal pain, bloating, fatigue. It can also go to fever, sometimes rectal bleeding, sometimes bloody diarrhea, loss of weight, loss of appetite. So it has a very wide range of symptoms that they share with other problems. I always tell my patients is, these symptoms are not just specific for colitis, they're not specific for irritable bowel syndrome, they're not specific for colon cancer. You need someone to figure out which is which, so it's gonna affect the treatment.
And what about these symptoms? Will they flare up right after you eat or several hours after you eat during the digestive process? When would you see those red flags?
Basically, the red flags are always if you start having diarrhea and that stays for more than 3 days, you tried some over-the-counter medications, it didn't improve, you should be seeing a physician to figure out why you're having diarrhea all of a sudden. Now, it can follow food, and that, like food poisoning, can cause some gastroenteritis and colitis. They have some shared symptoms and presentations. But also, it could be an early symptom for a long-term disease that it may stay for a lifetime, like Crohn's or ulcerative colitis.
Oh, I see. And there's no cure then, absolute cure.
It depends on what kind of colitis, actually. There are diseases that our goal is to control the symptoms. Some diseases, we are able to control them away from flare-up stages and preventing any complications in the future. And there are diseases that are curable.
All right. Well, Doctor, we'll get back to this. I think we do have a phone call coming in now. It might get off topic just a little bit, but we'll steer you back onto colitis. But we do open our phones for anyone who has any questions tonight, especially with any colorectal situations or problems that you might have. Let's go to the phones on line one with Richard. Hi, Richard. Your question, please.
Yes, I was wondering what causes lackadaisical colon. It doesn't operate properly. There's not cancer there, but what would cause the colon just to be lackadaisical and not operate properly.
Never heard that before.
Actually, I think you're talking about the colon being very lazy and not functioning well, Richard. And there are different types, actually, of presentations for this. We see people with constipation. And there is one entity that people have what we call it lazy colon or a slow transit colon. And that's the kind of the colon that when you check them by colonoscopy, there is no abnormal findings in their colon. Mm. But it's a problem with the nervous system that control the colon system, which affects the contractility. And there is a lot of ways of modification regarding diet and liquid and activity that can help these people at the early stages. In some cases that some people, they may not benefit unless we proceed to surgery, which is gonna be the
All right, very good. Richard, thank you very much for your phone call tonight. We'll go to line two in just a moment with Judy. She has a question, but I want to get back to colitis because I don't want to steer too far away from it. You mentioned that there were several types of colitis. What are the most common types, if you could bring those up? Because we'll probably encounter those along the way in life. And the ones that you see the most often in your office?
We see Crohn's disease. Crohn's, it's a form of inflammatory bowel disease that affects any part of your small bowel, large bowel, even the mouth and the stomach. Mm-hmm. But when it gets to the colon, it becomes colitis, Crohn's colitis. Another form is ulcerative colitis. And these are a big group of the colitis that we treat. In addition to this, what I just mentioned about the Clostridium difficile, or what's known as C. diff colitis, which happens now a lot, most of the times in hospitals, people who are staying there for a long time, in the long-term facilities, nursing homes, people who receive chemo treatment or radiation. And at the end, it always goes to people who have weaker immune system. And that sometimes happens just from taking an antibiotic. You take an antibiotic for surgery or for medical problems, and that kills the bacteria that you have normally in your colon. And what it does is actually it affects the balance of the bacteria that we need in our colon for absorption and the function. And people end with having severe diarrhea. And that sometimes have different phases or different stages. It can be a very mild disease that can be treated as outpatient. It can get to a point, become severe by severe dehydration, generalized weakness. People need to be admitted to the hospital. And in some cases, it become really a severe condition that we have to put it to ICU, and sometimes we may consider surgery.
Wow. And preparing for this show, I noticed in some of the information that I was reading that C. diff can actually affect your heartbeat.
Definitely.
How is that?
Any diarrhea disease can affect your heartbeat in a sense of if you have severe diarrhea, you get fluid depleted. If you get fluid depleted, your heart starts running really fast. You develop what we call tachycardia.
I see.
Try to compensate for the less volume of fluid that you have in your system. Now, that's one way. The other way is actually, if the colitis from the C. diff become really severe, it can involve the entire thickness of the wall of the colon. And that's when we really get worried about perforation of the colon or holes in the colon, and then the toxins can go to your blood system. And then you become septic and having all effects in your entire body with tachycardia, you have your blood pressure will can go low and all things like that.
Who's most at risk to get colitis?
That's a very good question in a sense of depends on what type of colitis.
Oh, okay.
Actually, recently I have one of my patients, she works at the zoo, and she developed a severe diarrhea for which she came to the hospital. Mm. And the first thought was maybe she has C. diff colitis. And then when we went further and testing her stool studies and doing a colonoscopy, we proved that she has a salmonella. And most likely she's getting that from encounter with the animals. And then we tested actually one of the animals in the zoo, and we have the matched strain that she had.
I see.
So it depends on exposure, actually. I think people who handle a lot of elderly patients in nursing facilities, people who visit hospitals, they have to follow basic hygiene concepts in a sense of washing hands before you get to the hospital, washing hands after you get to the hospital, after you have an encounter with someone who's been on a lot of medications and antibiotics. Very simple measures, but it can have long-term effects.
And obviously, some forms are contagious.
Yes, definitely.
Wow. Okay, I didn't realize that. Well, we'll get back to colitis in just a moment. We will go to line two with Judy. Judy, thank you so much for calling Healthline tonight. Your question for Dr. Elhassan?
Yes, sir. I have lost 60 pounds within the last year. I went to the doctor. I am having a lot of problems when I eat. It goes straight through my bowels. They did a colonoscopy, and they found two polyps, but he couldn't get a clear view. The polyps were benign. Now I'm going to see a gastroenterologist next week and have an endoscopy done. But they're going to check me also for Crohn's disease. I mean, is there any other procedure they could do to find out what is going on?
Okay. Thank you, Judy, for this question. Actually, Crohn's could be a good possibility, but I will think about it other things, about different types of colitis that can cause diarrhea or food to go through you. And that will make me need to look at your colonoscopy report and if they've done any biopsies. One group of the colitis that I didn't mention is called microscopic colitis, which is a group of people that they will have severe diarrhea, loss of weight, and it happens in people above 50 most of the time, and female. And when we do a colonoscopy, actually it was grossly normal. But when we do biopsies under the microscope, then we find some changes in the lining of the walls that tells this is microscopic colitis, and then there are some small subgroups of the colitis itself, the microscopic colitis, and there are specific treatment that can help you with that. I think going to see a gastroenterologist is a very, very good idea to start with. I think an upper endoscopy also is a very good thing to make sure that you don't have anything affecting your upper part of the stomach or the esophagus.
All right. Very good. And Judy, thank you very much for calling in. Best of luck with that. Let's go to line one with Mary Ann. Hi, Mary Ann. Your question, please.
Well, my question is, what is the prescribed treatment for ulcerative colitis?
Okay. Mary Ann, it's actually a very good question related to what we're talking about today. Ulcerative colitis has different stages. It's a kind of a disease that you will have for long term. It's a long life disease that you will have. I always tell my patients it's like diabetes or high blood pressure. It's a disease that you have to know how to control it better. You may not be able to get rid of ulcerative colitis at all. Now, one important thing with ulcerative colitis, we're always worried about this risk of cancer. Ulcerative colitis put people at a higher risk of colon cancer,
wow,
especially after 10 years from diagnosis. So you need to be followed on that very closely. Regarding the treatment, it depends on what phase of the disease you are. There are different levels of medications. We start with anti-inflammatory medications like mesalamine compounds and sulfasalazine compounds, and there are different medications in the market. Steroids also are a good option when you have a very severe attacks or flare-ups, and there are actually more stronger medications that affect the immune system with ulcerative colitis.
Mm, okay, very good. Thank you very much, Mary Ann, for calling. Let's talk about some other areas of bowel problems, if you will, the irritable bowel syndrome. Now, is that a form of colitis?
Okay, that's, I'm very happy that you touched on this because irritable bowel syndrome actually is a complete different entity from colitis. And people used to mix these two terms. Hmm. And we always talk as physician about this. This is the diagnosis by exclusion. Actually, because it shares the same symptoms with colitis and with colon cancer, Crohn's, ulcerative, by having bloating, diarrhea, constipation, loss of appetite, and all that actually can share the same symptoms with irritable bowel syndrome.
Right.
But in the group of people with irritable bowel syndrome, whenever we check their colon, their lining of the colon is completely normal. So it's completely different entity from colitis. It has to do with the nervous function of the colon itself. It has to do with the contractility. As I said earlier, the lining of the colon from inside is a mucosal layer. If you go outside, the layers after that are muscles, which helps the contractility of the colon to move the waste products towards the rectum.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in some people with irritable bowel syndrome, you may have those contractility or these functions stronger than normal, and they may last longer, and that's where people present with diarrhea or cramping. In other people of irritable bowel syndrome, it may be slower, and it lasts for less shorter time, and that actually gets them to have more constipation.
All right, and you know, irritable bowel syndrome or colitis, how do you finally know? Do you diagnose it? What tests are involved?
Okay, there's a lot of tests, actually. When we talk about colitis specifically, physician will look at all the symptoms and the signs on the examination, fever, abdominal distension, tenderness, and then we go to blood work. We want to make sure that your white blood cell count is normal, there is no signs of infection. We check electrolytes, make sure you don't have dehydration, your kidney functions are normal. And then we go further to check your stool studies. If you have diarrhea, we want to make sure there is no infection like Shigella, Salmonella, OVA, any kind of parasites, or even the C. diff colitis that we talked about. If all that's negative, our next step will be always a colonoscopy.
Mm-hmm.
To look at the colon and do random biopsies, and like the case of Judy, to make sure that there is no microscopic colitis or any different types of colitis. If all that's ruled out, then we have to talk about another subgroup of people who have lactose intolerance or people have sensitivity to specific substances like wheat, like gluten, like celiac disease.
Right.
And there are specific tests to rule all this. Once everything is ruled out, then we can talk about irritable bowel syndrome and what we can do about it.
Okay, very good. Let's go to line two with Rosano, who's calling on Healthline tonight. Rosano, always a pleasure speaking to you. Go ahead with your question.
Yes. For the last 5 years, my hematocrit has been a little below. It's below 40. The numbers are usually like 37 and 38. My hemoglobin is a little bit low, like 13.1. And some doctors suspected of colon cancer or some other digestive cancer. Could that be?
Okay. That's a very good question. Anemia is actually one of the presentations of colon cancer. And people, they may say, I don't see any blood in my stool. But I always tell them, if the colon is about 5 feet, if you start having a tumor that's losing and you're bleeding from it on the right side of your colon, most likely you're losing a small amount of blood over the long term. And you may not see any blood in your stool because it's digested, and that could be an early sign for colon cancer, definitely. Mm-hmm. If you have anemia, really my advice is to have a colonoscopy, and this will put the whole issue to rest. I mean, if you have full colonoscopy, we'll say 100% you don't have a colon cancer or a colon polyp or anything that's bleeding, then you can look at other factors that can affect and cause the anemia itself.
Okay, very good. What do diet and colitis have in common, or how do they relate?
Okay. When people are going through the active phase of colitis, we always try to treat the colon by giving it some rest. And by that we mean we go for like a low fiber diet. Mm-hmm. We encourage people to drink a lot of liquid and low fat diet. Now, after the resolution of the acute phase, it depends on what kind of colitis you are. If you have salmonella colitis or C. diff colitis, I always tell people after resolution of all your symptoms and everything goes back to normal, you can go back and eat whatever you want. There is no restriction. Now, with people with C. diff colitis, there is another advice about starting having more yogurt in your diet or having what's now in the market is the probiotics. Mm-hmm. And the whole idea about that is you're encouraging your colon to form new balance in the balance between the bacteria that you have in your colon to have more healthy bacteria so you don't give a chance to the C. diff colitis to flourish again.
I see. So the yogurt is actually a good thing.
It's a good thing for people who have C. diff colitis who are recovering from that.
All right.
Yeah, and some people actually, it may make things worse. So you have to do these things under supervision of a physician because if you have some degree of lactose intolerance and you're taking yogurt, you're just going to make things worse.
Mm-hmm. Now, you touched on this earlier in the show, and for those who are watching, we want to make sure that we recap these, especially as we become toward the end of the show. And by the way, we're still taking your phone calls at 969-2720 or long distance at 969-2720. I don't know how many times I've said that on the show, but I don't call the number, so therefore. But we want to make sure that we go over the symptoms and those red flags, and if people do encounter those, who they should call first and see first before they're referred to a colorectal surgeon.
Okay.
So what are those symptoms?
We talk about diarrhea. If you have diarrhea more than 3 days, you try it over-the-counter medications without significant improvement, you should contact your family doctors. Mm. They will start the first basic measures, checking your stool studies, checking your white blood cell count, being evaluated for not being dehydrated. I always tell people, if you start having diarrhea, the most important thing is make sure you drink a lot of liquid, you stay hydrated. This is the first step you have to do. Now, there's other things. If you have blood in your stool, regardless if you're having diarrhea or no, this is a very red flag. You have to be seen, you have to be evaluated. I always tell people 90% of the bleeding that people have is most likely related to hemorrhoids or fissures or something very localized. But the 10% of people that they think this is their problem, actually, it turned out to be colon cancer that's been missed.
Right, and Dr. Jim Edlin, who you work with, when he comes on this program, he always mentions that any blood in the stool needs investigation.
Yes.
That's one of his
favorite
sayings.
And nobody can agree with this anymore.
Okay, very good. Let's go to, we have two more calls coming in. Let's go to line two. I think Rick was first. Rick, your question, please, for Dr. Elhassan, please.
Oh, yes. Medical surgeon Dr. Stan Monteith, he reports that colon cancer, one of the primary causes is meat. When you look at these cattle, they're treated with antibiotics and bovine growth hormones and vaccines, and then we wind up eating these. Have you seen any research in that correlating meat with colon cancer? Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for calling.
Okay. Thank you, Rick, for this question. There is no clear evidence, one level, to prove that eating pure meat is just the cause of colon cancer. Colon cancer has a lot of factors affecting it. Genetics playing a big factor. We know eating food that has high fat contents, definitely over a long term, can make a lot of changes in the biologic level between the mucosal lining of the cells to get to a polyp and then get to a cancer. Mm-hmm. Having a history of colon polyp, having a family history of colon cancer. So there's a lot of factors that put people at higher risk of colon cancer than others.
All right, very good. And then we have Jan on line one. Hi, Jan. Thank you for calling. Your question, please.
Yes. I have a lot of polyps, and what do I do about it?
Okay, Jan. Regarding your colon polyps, you have to be seen and followed by a specialist, either colorectal surgeon or a gastroenterologist, because it has to do with the number of the polyps, and the nature of the polyps. I mean, the microscopic findings on these polyps, are they hyperplastic? Are they adenomatous polyp? There are polyps that are actually very precancerous, like high-grade dysplasia and things like that. And depends on these kind of polyps, you need to be followed very closely. Depends on their number and the microscopy of these polyps, I will say, or the histology of these polyps, will decide how often you need to have colonoscopies. Sometimes we put people on yearly basis colonoscopies, mm-hmm. and sometimes we need to wait 2 to 3 years or 5 years. And there are some group of people that if they have a lot of polyps, which put them in their group called familial adenomatous polyposis, these people actually sometimes we recommend surgery to take most of the colon out.
Right. And I know a lot of people have problems with even entertaining the thought of having a colonoscopy, and I'm one of those people, but I did have one 3 years ago, and it's nothing. It's a cinch. Mm-hmm. So I do, and they did find some polyps, and those were removed, and I was very grateful for that.
I always tell people, actually, it's something I think, regardless of how we think about it and how we're very afraid or scared or intimidated about the idea of the colonoscopy, but I always tell my patients the day of the colonoscopy, I think you ought to do this to the people you love and yourself.
Absolutely, absolutely. All right, well, line five has Carol. She prefers to be off the air, which is just fine. We're glad that you called, Carol. I want to read the question off the teleprompter here. She's asking, could you discuss the effects of ulcerative colitis when it causes the removal of the colon, living with a waste bag attached to oneself?
Okay. That's a very good question, actually. As I mentioned earlier, ulcerative colitis is one of the diseases that we're always worried about the risk of cancer. And once you pass 10 years with ulcerative colitis, you have to be in a very close screening program so you don't miss a colon cancer. That's one. The second thing is people with ulcerative colitis in their very severe form, they may present with severe bleeding that doesn't stop. They may present with severe infections that cause sepsis, and they may present with perforation of their colon. Mm-hmm. And in these groups of people, in addition to the people with the high risk of the cancer, we advise people to have a colon resection. And most of the time is the options are taking the entire colon out and the rectum, and having a colostomy or a stool bag. That's one of the options. There is a lot of options now about creating what we call it ileal pouch, which make a pouch of your small bowel, hook it back to your rectum down there, so you won't have a colostomy. And even if you have it, you'll have it sometime temporary.
Is it true that fewer and fewer people are having the colostomy bags? There are other ways that you just
There are a lot of options now available to people. Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's good, and I'm sure a lot of people are relieved to know that. Let's go ahead and change subjects since we have a couple of minutes left in the program. Some of the more common things that you deal with in your office besides colitis, do you see much bowel obstruction?
Okay. Bowel obstruction is related to two things. One is there are a group of people who have bowel obstruction without surgery in the past, and there are people who have previous surgeries. In women, they have hysterectomy or cesarean section. In men or women, they have appendix in the past or gallbladder surgery. And our body tends to make adhesions or scars for healing, and that's one of the main causes of bowel obstruction. Mm-hmm. People who present with bowel obstruction, they may need immediate surgery, or some group, they may need just admission to the hospital, rest for their bowel, and then things would resolve on its own. You have to be seen by a surgeon if you have a bowel obstruction to be evaluated, definitely.
All right. I think we have time for one more call, and I think they're taking care of that caller right now. If we could go to line two with Bill, we'll wrap up our show with Bill as our last question. Bill, go ahead.
What is Fisher's?
Okay. Fisher is basically, the easy way to make it is if you have a crack or a cut in your lip, it's exactly the same thing as you have a cut in the lining of the anal canal, and actually at the anus level. It causes severe pain, severe bleeding sometimes. The main thing is pain, and it's usually happen in people who have issues with constipation and bowel habits. It's a treatable condition. It doesn't cause cancer for most of the time, unless it's it's consistent with some people who have Crohn's disease or some people who have ulcerative colitis, then it becomes a risk for cancer.
And how is that treated?
The fissures are treated by different types of creams, and there are different options actually surgically and injections that can help.
And there are such things as the minor ones and the major ones, and of course, minor or major, they should be checked out, is that correct?
Definitely. Any rectal bleeding, like fissures present with rectal bleeding and present with rectal pain, you need to be checked. You need to be examined to see if this is really a fissure or something else.
All right. Dr. Hisham Elhassan, a colon and rectal surgeon, we thank you very much for being here, for your candid discussion, and obviously you're an expert in your field, and we appreciate you being here tonight.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Please come back.
Thank you.
All right. That's going to wrap up our show tonight. Now, next Tuesday night, we'll be back with Dr. Hollis Chastain and peripheral artery disease, another very interesting program. And make sure you have your questions ready and call us here on Healthline. Until then, I'm Mark Evans. On behalf of everyone here at PBS 39, we wish you the best of health always, and we thank you for watching and your support. Good night.